The idea of sending any kind of message wirelessly is still revolutionary. The newly invented telephone needs cables to carry a signal. So does the telegraph when it sends out messages in Morse code. But demand is growing for communication that doesn't need wires, especially in the shipping industry. Sending a voice across an ocean without wires would be a huge breakthrough. In the late 1800s, Reginald Fessenden is one of many scientists fascinated by a concept called spark gap transmission. He's hoping it's the ticket to a great leap forward in communication. If only these sparks could generate waves of energy strong enough to carry a human voice. As a young man, he worked for Thomas Edison, laying cable under the streets of New York.
He soon achieved a promotion and was eventually hired by Edison's own lab, and very quickly was appointed Edison's chief chemist.
Fessenden proved to be naturally brilliant at everything, from chemistry to electrical engineering. That got him noticed by another big name, Westinghouse, where he worked with X-ray machines and other things that use electromagnetic radiation. Problem is, a radio wave produced by the spark method fades away quickly, so it's not able to carry understandable voice signals.
The lack of amplification was a massive problem. In 1903, Lee DeForest thinks that the solution to delivering a powerful radio signal to millions of people can be found by experimenting with gas and electricity.
He comes up with this strange object. It's a gas-filled bulb with three electrodes designed to amplify radio signals. He calls it the Audion.
The initial tests of the Audion are very encouraging. DeForest plans a grand public demonstration to showcase his marvelous new invention. The broadcast was a disaster. The press laughed at him, and later, DeForest was even arrested for fraud, accused of overselling the value of the Audion to his shareholders. In 1913, DeForest sells the Audion patent at a bargain price to pay legal bills.
As Fessenden ponders how to solve this problem, a European makes headlines. On December 12, 1901, an Italian called Marconi transmits a wireless signal in Morse code across the Atlantic. What surprises Fessenden is not that Marconi has pulled it off, but that he's bragging about it. If Marconi had sent a wireless voice across the Atlantic, now that would be news. Fessenden thinks it might be possible to create a continuous radio wave with a machine called an alternator that turns mechanical energy into electrical energy. But he needs a machine hundreds of times more powerful than any alternator in existence. By the summer of 1906, General Electric does deliver a high-powered alternator. But even this machine isn't powerful enough. So Fessenden spends months making his own adjustments to produce an even stronger electrical current. Now, he thinks he's ready to test his theory. He hooks the alternator up to a microphone at one end and the world's largest antenna at the other. Here's how it's supposed to work. When a person speaks into the microphone, it creates sound waves. The sound waves will hitch a ride on the much stronger, faster moving radio waves created by the alternator. The alternator then sends this composite or modulated wave to the antenna, which transmits it to a receiver in some faraway place. On Christmas Eve of 1906, in Brant Rock, Massachusetts, it's time to put Fessenden's theory to the test. Hundreds of kilometers away on the Atlantic Ocean, ships suddenly receive a message in standard Morse code.
What have you got, lad?
Be prepared for something of great interest to follow.
It's a heads up from Fessenden, who wants to make sure every sailor is paying attention to what happens next. It's an astonishing sound. For the first time ever, a voice is transmitted over great distance without cables and wires. Fessenden has successfully transported sound on a continuous radio wave, a concept called amplitude modulation, or AM radio. Problem is, a radio wave produced by the spark method makes a nasty noise.
Lee DeForest's big error was believing that the gas inside the Audion could amplify a radio signal. Over the next decade, researchers experimented with his basic design. They took the gas out of the bulb, and suddenly it worked a whole lot better. That was the birth of the vacuum tube,
triggering an electronics revolution.
Radar, television, VCRs, sound recording, amplifiers, X-rays, and microwave ovens all become commercially viable, thanks to the vacuum tube.